Ask not what we all be can do for you. Ask what you can do for we all be.
Hi, welcome to this special edition of The Artivist Presents We All Be Radio. I'm your special host for the hour, R2C2H2, The Artivist. Please feel free to call us at 646-652-4593 if you'd like to join in on this wonderful conversation that's about to take place. Or if you're scared and don't want to be on the air, you can email us with your questions or comments at r2c2h2@gmail.com. That's alphabet R, numeric 2, alphabet C, numeric 2, alphabet H, numeric 2, @gmail.com. And here we go. Area code 212.
Yes.
The Mr. Michael Holman, the one and only, the original.
That's
no
me.
Imitation. Renaissance Man Extraordinaire.
That's
how
me.
You doing today on We All Be Radio?
I'm stupid fresh.
Stupid fresh out there, yes, sir. I'm glad you was able to make it back because I really enjoyed you on Sunday, this special Sunday. It was like our most listened to show, and people really comment on how brilliant you are as far as breaking down the culture and what you bring to the table.
Well, I really had a great time, I have to tell you. You know, it was really a lot of fun. And I still want to know who the brother was who said he had too much money to be right, because I could help
him
with that.
I talked to him. I'm definitely going to use the information. I had the pleasure of talking to him. I didn't talk to him, but he left a message. And I'll pass that along to you. Now,
yeah, I mean, I don't mean to be, inconsiderate or rude, but you know, it's just that you never know. Somebody like him might have some interest in some of the things that I'm developing. So, who knows?
You're right. Let's talk about you now. Like, can you tell us the audience? I know you teach at Howard University. I know you're a Renaissance man. I know you're a filmmaker. You're a musician. You're a visual artist. Basically, everything you do, you're exceptional at it.
Thank you.
Yeah, I really believe me. I told a friend of mine, I said, like, you know, I wish I, you know, a lot of ways, I'm glad I always get you right now because it's such a treat to have you on. And I just like to let you talk to the listeners out there. Well, you know, you can stop the conversation any way we want to. But I guess before I get started, though, I'd like to get into Jean Michel Basquiat because I know that's why I wanted to ask you on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And I know we talked about it a little bit. Like, I wanted to hear your opinion. Did you know that Jean Michel Basquiat was going to be the person that he became or the legend?
Well, I'll tell you, I remember the very first moment that I met him. I mean, it was so memorable. And I suppose it's an interesting and probably long-winded way of answering you.
Oh, please.
It was April 29th, 1979. And I had been in New York just about a year at that point because I'd come to New York in May of 78. I was hanging out with my friend, a very good friend, Stan Peskett, who's a British artist, a little older than me, who I knew from the Tubes when I was in this band called the Tubes, which was like a conceptual art rock band that had stage sets and props and actors and costumes that would go along with their music.
Mm-hmm.
And it was something that David Bowie had been doing as well in the 70s. It was a lot of fun, and I really learned and cut my teeth in show business back then. Anyway, so I come to New York, and Stan is one of the few friends I know and I have in New York, and we would hang out and plan things, and we would do all kinds of interesting art projects and photo shoots, and at this point, which is really kind of interesting too, a lot of people who I tell this to can't believe it, but at this point, I'm working at Chemical Bank as a credit analyst.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of like, you know, a corporate kind of banker role, junior banker. And a lot of people I tell this to, they can't believe that I was ever a banker. And I was working in Wall Street, and it was pretty funny. But I'm just like right out of college, and I'm like I said, a junior banker. You know, it's more of like a learning program than really out there doing it. And so during the daytime, I'd be at Chemical Bank. And, you know, during the week, and then at night, I'd be going out to clubs like Max's Kansas City or sometimes
mm-hmm.
Studio 54, which I didn't really like that much. I thought the Mud Club and other funkier clubs were more fun. And on the weekends, I'd hang out with my friend Stan, and, you know, we'd roll a little something-something and,
uh-huh.
You know, let our minds get free
mm-hmm.
and talk about, like, interesting and creative. He was a lot like me, like an armchair anthropologist, talk about how countries were different, why music was cool, why certain art was great, you know, and create and come up with plans. And I remember on one of these weekend sessions, I'm looking through the Village Voice, and I spot this article, and it's talking about a guy who's got a graffiti organization called the Fabulous Five, and it was Fab Five Freddy. And I said, Stan, check a look at this. Look at this guy, Fab Five Freddy. Let's invite him over to one of our sessions and see what he's about. Mm. He sounds like an interesting cat, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how I got his name or number. I think I called the voice and finally got his number, and he was living in Brooklyn. And so he says, yeah, I'll come on over. And he comes over, and we're like shooting the breeze and talking and stuff. And we come up with this idea to have a party. And the party was my friend Stan's studio, loft studio, big loft studio, was on Canal Street right near the Hudson River, and he called it the Canal Zone, and it was a place where a lot of really interesting people came along. And now that I think about it, I met some really interesting people there. I met Jean Michel Basquiat there. I met Fab Five Freddy there. I met Malcolm McLaren there from the Sex Pistols.
Mm.
You know, the manager of the Sex Pistols and Bow Wow Wow and the whole, anyway. So back to Fab Five Freddy. So we're hanging out, and Freddy says, yeah, you know, I've got this graffiti organization. And one of my star graffiti artists was Lee Kionis, and you know, we go around and we do all kinds of interesting things. And so Stan and Freddy and I decided, let's have a party. And the party would be, the theme of the party would be graffiti. And again, now this is early in the hip-hop game. This is before hip-hop's even called hip-hop.
Mm.
And very few people were really knew what was going on. There was very little contact between the downtown people and uptown people. And, you know, the hip-hop kids, the black and Puerto Rican kids uptown in the Bronx and whatever, and the downtown artists who were a mix of, you know, white, black, and everything else. And so so we're planning this party, and we're going to have giant plastic rolls of clear plastic, and Lee Kionis and Fab Five Freddy and the rest of his crew of the Fabulous Five graffiti artists did all these different graffiti tags on the clear plastic, which I think that plastic must have been at least 10 feet high. It was really fantastic, and then we hoisted it up. And we called all of our friends, and Freddie called his friends, and we just put out a general alarm out there for people to come down. And somehow Jean-Michel Basquiat heard about this. I don't know how. I didn't know him at the time. I hadn't met him yet. And Jean was on a mission. He had always been on a mission to be famous, to be important, to be recognized, to have his talent, you know, reach the highest ends of the highest heights of modern art. And I don't know if he thought about it consciously much. He just was in perpetual motion. He just was going to do it. And so he hears about this, and I'm just imagining him saying, you know, I want to be down. So he shows up, and he's kind of quiet and circumspect. At this point, he had a blonde, like, short, widow's peak, like, haircut. Like, his hair was really short. It was dyed. He dyed it blonde, and then he shaved his hair back so that he had, like, this widow's peak, so that his forehead was unusually long and large, going back to the sort of middle of his skull. And right there would start the widow's peak of blonde hair, and then he'd have this blonde thing going on the back of his head, which was like an unusual look for a young black man at that point.
And, yeah.
And I would say he was, so it was 79, so he was like 19 years old, because he was born in 1960. He would have been 18. He was almost 19 because his birthday was in August, I think. Anyway, that's a good question. But anyway, so I'm going around at the party with a tape machine. A video camera, and I've got a microphone plugged into the video camera. And there's this guy. I think his name was George. He was videotaping me interviewing everybody. And so I would walk up to people. It was like a crowded jumping party. There was people there from like the whole Studio 54 scene. There were people there from Max's Kansas City scene, which is more of like an early punk scene. There was people there from uptown, from the art scene, not way uptown, but like upper Broadway in Manhattan, people from the downtown art scene, etc. And of course, there were some like kids from Brooklyn and some and from the graffiti scene as well, because they were all letting their friends know. Freddie's friends were letting their friends know. So it was a nice crowd. And I would go up and interview people, and this is all on tape. I would go up and interview people and say, "So tell us all about yourself." And I put the microphone in their face for them to respond, and then I'd pull the microphone back as soon as they were about to answer and ask them another question, and then I'd put the microphone back and they would go to answer again, and I'd pull it back, and it was kind of, I don't know why I did it. I think unconsciously I was feeling hostile towards them because I was interviewing them and I wasn't being interviewed.
I got you.
You know, so I came up with this like cute, silly, funny way of like kind of being, I don't know, creative, conceptual. I think looking back on it was like really stupid, but I was doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I did it to about four or five people. And then came Jean. Now, before I had interviewed Jean, when Jean showed up, and he said, I want to be part of this, because there was all this graffiti on this plastic, on this hanging, you know, clear plastic, sheets of plastic.
Mm-hmm.
So Stan gave him a roll of gray photo paper. Now, gray photo, you know, it's like photo paper used to do photo shoots, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the paper was, I'd say, and again, I have this on video, I'd say the photo paper was a good 8 feet to 9 feet wide, and he gets while everyone else was doing graffiti, you know, like hip hop graffiti burners, you know, like multicolor burners.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't do that kind of graffiti. His graffiti was more pure to the term, the Greek term, which is basically writing political slogans on walls, right? With scratching them on walls, you know, 2,000 years ago.
Right.
John is more of that type of graffiti artist. And he had already been known around town. No one knew for sure who it was. But he and his friend, Al Diaz, were going around all over the Soho where all the galleries were at this point, tagging up. But his tags were poems. Like, he would write things like, "Plush safe, he think, copyright Samo." Or,
uh-huh,
"Pin drops like a pungent odor, copyright Samo." or "Make soup, build a fort, set that on fire, copyright Samo." And he was into this idea of automatic writing, which William Burroughs had kind of made famous. But really, you know who actually invented automatic writing? And what automatic writing is, let me explain really quickly, is somebody who wants to do, like, say, a poem, and they want to write a very abstract kind of existential poem that involves like all kinds of misleading words that don't connect but somehow sound great. They might look through a newspaper and grab a word in this article and then put it together with a word over in this article and then put it together in a word over in this article. And when you make the sentence, it doesn't really make sense, but it's kind of beautiful, like a pin drops like a pungent odor. Like,
right,
he might have picked up a pin drops from one article or one book or something and then a pungent odor from somewhere else and put it together and goes, "Wow, a pin drops like a pungent odor. That, it doesn't make sense, but yet it sounds beautiful."
Uh-huh.
So this is what he was doing. So, you know, in New York in those days, and everyone knew who about him, but nobody really knew who he was. It was a big mystery. But there were a lot of weird, mysterious graffiti artists. Like, there was somebody who would scratch the word "pray," P-R-A-Y, on all the coin-operated telephone booths in New York. And now, that would be quite visible because nobody had cell phones in those days. Everybody used pay phones, and everyone knew, "Oh, yeah, who's this cat that does pray?" Turned out to be a woman, funny enough. So anyway, Jean shows up, and he wants to be part of this graffiti thing at this party, the Canal Zone party. So Stan Pesca gives him a big roll of gray photo paper. He grabs a paint can and starts spray painting one of his typical graffiti pieces, which went like this. It said in letters, I'd say, that were about a foot and a half tall, he wrote, like, reaching up high, started, "Which of the following symbols are omnipresent?" with a question mark. And then below that, the first line would have a square box, and it would say A, Lee Harvey Oswald, for your listeners, is the man who supposedly assassinated John F. Kennedy.
Sounds like I said that.
And then B, Coca-Cola. C, Disney. D, Samo, or something to that effect. I mean, he would write these things. Which of the following symbols are omnipresent? A, Lee Harvey Oswald. B, Coca-Cola. C, Disney. E, D, Samo, copyright, you know, whatever. And it was like, whoa, what does this mean? This guy's not doing graffiti that's visual at all. It's cerebral. It's mental. It's psychological. It's poetic. And in a way, he was doing lines as strong as a lot of the really good, you know, MCs who battle, you know, using like beautiful poetry, not your typical boring rapper, but you know, really brilliant, like battling MCs. But he was off now saying that and writing something like that, while these other brothers from Brooklyn are basically doing like, you know, big, you know, burners with their names and stuff. Jean is looking like not only like a genius, not that they're not looking brilliant or whatever, but he's looking not only like a genius, but like a mad scientist. And many of the people that have known him would say that he was like a realized being, meaning, which is like a Buddhist's, a Zen Buddhist definition of somebody who transcends being human,
right.
Frankly. Jean really transcended being human. Jean was something above human. I mean, I know that sounds weird, but and maybe even sacrilegious on certain anthropological level, but Jean was had such a brilliant mind. His paintings, which he's famous for, which, by the way, I don't know how many people know this, but sell in auction today for anywhere up to $6 to $7 million.
Mm-hmm.
There's no black artist that has anything close to that, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Romare Bearden, you know, Alma Thompson, Bob Thompson, you name any of the
right.
artists that came out in the 50s and 60s, they didn't really blow up that well. Romare Bearden was pretty big. But, you know, Jean is truly the biggest, most famous, most important black painter that ever lived. His paintings sell more than his paintings sell more than any of his contemporaries, like the Julian Schnabels, the Keith Herrings, all the white artists that he came up with.
Right.
Well, he's dead. Well, so is Keith Haring. His work doesn't come close to Jean's work in value. Doesn't come close. Keith Haring's work I don't think approaches $1 million. Jean's are $6 million. The world was fascinated with him. So now he's doing this piece, and now it's my turn to interview him.
Mm-hmm.
So you see I'm jumping around here.
That was cool.
And I'm like, you know, I decide to pull the same thing. I go up to him and I say, here's Jean-Michel. This is everybody I'd like to introduce. This is Samo. He's the guy who you see his name all over the place. And he and Jean corrected me and he said, it's Samo. And I said, oh, okay, Samo. And I said, okay, so tell me, da-da-da. I forgot what I asked him. I need to, like, watch this tape to see it. This is a very valuable tape. And I put the microphone in his face, and he goes to answer. And now think about it. Jean is, like, on a mission to be who he became. It's like being a realized being. He knew his future. He knew he was going to become the most famous black artist that ever lived. He knew he was going to become one of the most famous artists, period. He's this new generation's Andy Warhol, for Christ's sake, right?
Mm-hmm.
He knows this. He can see the future. I'm convinced. And so he has gotten no press. He's gotten nobody's interview. I'm probably the first person that ever interviewed him, now that I think about it.
Wow.
And so here I am, you know, about to ask him a bunch of questions and have him answer them. And like, I'm pulling the microphone away when he goes to answer them. And he's all eager to answer, and so when I pulled away, he kind of like leans in to try to get to them. And I ask another question, I put the microphone in his face, and I pull it away before he can answer. And then I did it a third time, and I put the microphone in his face, and he wasn't going to go for it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he just gave me a look. Now, this look that I'm going to tell you about is very, very, very special. Jean-Michel Basquiat, now I've heard this from other friends of mine, like Nancy Brooks Brody, who's a painter, who I told her the story. She said, "Michael, he did the exact same thing to me." And and his girlfriend, Suzanne Malouk, who, by the way, Suzanne and I are going to be doing tours around the country at different universities, telling these stories.
Wow.
Showing these films, showing these photographs, showing these paintings. So anybody out there that's interested in us coming, as a matter of fact, I think the first place we're going to do this at is going to be the Art Institute of Chicago, which is a really major Midwest art school. But anyway, so I take the microphone away, and he gives me this look. Now, this look, I have to describe this look. It's fascinating. The best way I can describe this look is, at first he kind of looked upset, like, you know, what are you doing? Or, you know, he kind of had a look on his face, and he was a man of very few words. And then I watched as all emotion, all judgment, all thought, all everything drained from his face, from his mind. His face went from consternation to just a blank, to absolute zero expression. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And you know what I found myself looking at when I looked in his face? I saw myself not looking at Jean Michel Basquiat, but because of what he had done, this special technique, I found myself looking in a mirror, looking at myself playing the fool.
Mm-hmm.
And I started stuttering. I couldn't get the word out. And later on, I went up to him, and I was really contrite, and I said, you know, Jean, you know, my name's Michael Holman, and, you know, I'm really sorry about that back there. I don't know what I was doing. And right away, he cut me off, and he said, "That's okay, man. You want to start a band?" And I went, "Sure, yeah, okay, yeah, let's start a band, man." I was like the coolest person that had ever chilled my bones. It was like inviting me to be in a band with him. I was like, bet. And that night, April 29th, 1979, we started Gray, which it wasn't called Gray at that time, but Jean always named, he named the band, and all the different names we went through, they were his. I think the first name was Test Pattern, off of a television Test Pattern. They don't have those anymore, but back then, even that, up till the 70s, they still had Test Patterns on, you know, when a station would go off, there would be this pattern on it, a circular pattern with lines and squiggles, and sometimes there'd be an Indian's head for some reason on it. And that would go with a ooh for like the whole night until the next morning the station would come back on again. Mm-hmm. And so we called the band Test Pattern, and then after that we called it Channel 9 because Channel 9 was his favorite channel because it played Popeye commercials and it played Felix the Cat commercials. And Jean was a big fan of television and cartoons. And not, what am I saying, commercials? I meant Popeye cartoons and Felix the Cat cartoons. Jean loved Popeye and loved Felix the Cat. So did I. I mean, we came from similar generations. I was a little older than him. And Popeye and Felix the Cat were our favorites. There was such a weird, if you can ever see any of these cartoons on maybe the cartoon channels or whatever, if you can see these rare, you can see them on YouTube. I think you can see them if you have cable on you know, some of these cartoon channels. There's such a certain strange vibe to these cartoons. Such a weird, the music, the way that they're illustrated. Don't forget, Jean is like an illustrator and an artist, and he's looking at the way Popeye is drawn, and he's listening to the music and the way his voice and well blows me down. You know, all this different stuff. And Jean loved that, and so. So we named the band Channel 9, and then finally we named it Gray. But the band was – would you like me to tell you about the band, how we the kind of music we played and stuff?
Oh, yeah, we never going to get into that, but I had got I got some people that's waiting on to ask you some questions.
Oh, shit. Damn, I'm, like, talking. Sorry about
that. No. This is incredible stuff. I mean, this is, like, first-hand account stuff. I definitely will get into the Gray band and stuff like that. Is it based off the Gray's Anatomy?
Yes, it is.
Okay, and Jean Michel, y'all came up with the name together?
No, Jean came up with it.
So
we were walking around. We were walking past Washington Square Park, where the big arch is near NYU. And he said, I got the name of the band. And I was like, what? And I was ready to kind of get into an argument about it. Like, well, maybe I have an idea for a band. Actually, I named the band Bad Fools for like 1 month. We were called Bad Fools. And so he says, I've got the name. And I said, what? And he said, Gray. And I was like, Gray. Perfect. It said it all. When I tell you about the band, it'll make sense.
Mm. Well, I got this email from Nia in Atlanta.
Uh-huh.
It's very interesting. Nia says, she wanted to know this for you, and you, I guess you are more qualified than anybody to answer this question. Why, in your opinions, do blacks place emphasis more on musical artists and athletes and not on visual artists? Why has our community never truly embraced them or taught their importance? Why was Jean the only one to sell a million or more?
Great question. Fabulous question. I love it. And I'm really qualified. I'm qualified to answer. It doesn't mean my answer is correct. I'll give you an answer. It's a multi-tiered. Well, first of all, the question is multi-tiered, and the answer will have to be as well. I think the first question is why, and let me sort of paraphrase it. Why is the black community, African American community, if you will, so disconnected to its own black artists, fine artists? And why isn't fine art more embraced within the black community? Is that a fair
Yeah, I think that would be fair. I mean, yeah, definitely.
Well, I'll tell you why. One quick answer is this. First of all, fine arts, let's set graffiti aside. Let's set all the other arts aside, dance, music, theater, film, et cetera. Let's just talk about fine arts, meaning painting, sculpture, et cetera, right? The fine arts, I found in my experience, many, many years of living on the Lower East Side, living in the downtown art scene, being an artist myself, seeing how it all works, meeting many, many artists, regardless of their background, regardless of their race and whatever, I noticed the similarity. They were all middle class. Now, where am I leading with this? First of all, you rarely see working class or poor artists making it in the fine arts. Now I haven't addressed race yet. Hold on.
Right.
I'm talking about social economic background. Now I had people argue with me like why would that? I said, poor people, working class people backgrounds have done great in music, have done great in film, have done great in literature, et cetera, et cetera. But painting, for some reason, is different. It seems to have to be class specific. So now let's take a group of black middle class people, in which we challenge them, parents and young people, to embrace fine arts. Right. Well, the first negative reaction to that is going to be, well, we've struggled to rise out of poverty over the last 100, 200 years. The last thing I want is my child to become some artist and be a starving artist after we've worked so hard to become middle class. That's one answer. You dig? So we want you to be lawyers. We want you to be doctors. We want you to be engineers. We want you to be this. We want you to be the architects. It's the most artistic we'd like to see. Even that we don't want to see you do. So there is a fear by the black middle class, which is the class that needs to be engaged in fine arts, of fine art, because what it represents to them is poverty, is starving artists before you ever make it, and you may not ever make it, which is true, which is true, but it's unfortunate that they don't do that, that they don't embrace it. My uncle, Harold Hart, was the director, one of the first black directors of an important art gallery way back in the 50s and 60s, the Martha Jackson Gallery in Manhattan on 57th Street. And he represented some heavyweight artists, fine artists, back in those days. And he actually represented Alma Thompson, who was one of the most important female abstract painters. She's dead now. She was from D.C. Her heyday was in the 60s, in the 50s and 60s, and she was doing abstract art. And he said he would go to, he would fly to Chicago and visit with wealthy doctors, black doctors, and psychiatrists, and lawyers and whatnot to try to sell them art. And you know, he said he would be so frustrated. He'd always say they would never want to buy art, never wanted to buy art. They always, he said, it would piss him off. He said they'd rather buy mirrors than art. They didn't understand art. They didn't want to embrace art. And to this day, sadly, when great cutting-edge artists like Kara Walker, I don't know if anyone knows who Kara Walker is.
Right.
Jean Michel Basquiat, conceptual artists like David Hammons from Harlem. These artists are all primarily collected by white people. Black people with money don't collect them. Listen, I remember going to Russell Simmons, who was worth a fortune even at the time, and I was trying to tell him, man, you should buy some Basquiat. And he was like, I didn't want to know. Didn't want to know about Jean-Michel Basquiat. I remember going down with my paintings to Atlanta, showing them, and this guy from Spelman, who had an art class down at Spelman in Atlanta, invited me to come, black teacher, black students, to come talk about art in New York, and I did, and I was telling about Jean-Michel Basquiat, and I could tell none of them knew who he was.
Wow.
I said, wait a second, and then I said, do you know who Keith Haring is or Kenny Scharf? They knew who that was. They knew the white artists. They didn't know Jean. I was like, how could they not know? And after the class, I found out that the art teacher, who was black, didn't like Jean's work and didn't tell his black students about Jean-Michel Basquiat.
Hmm.
That's another level.
That's black on black crime, right?
That's
there.
Black on black crime in a big way. That's crime art crime. Thing. That's mm-hmm. art crime.
They like Marlon Brando, James Dean of art. I mean, how you not talking about
yeah,
that?
Yeah, he was. Jean was the Marlon Brando of art. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, and how could a black art teacher not tell his students about Jean-Michel Basquiat? He looked at Jean's work. Now, this is a failing on the community's part. Unfortunately, this art teacher looked at Jean's work and saw a mess. Saw just garbage. Saw like
wow.
Because Jean intentionally painted with the hand of a child. That's what made him brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
And some people say, "Oh, I could do that." Well, yeah, good. I'm glad if Jean inspires you. If Jean's work inspires you to say, "I could do that," then that is a positive thing.
Right.
Unfortunately, I have to say that I would say in our community that when it comes to fine art and when it comes to cutting edge music, when it comes to surreal film, when it comes to new wave film, we're afraid of it, and we embrace the commercial lowest common denominator crap that comes out of Hollywood and that comes out of we don't challenge ourselves, and we have to start doing that. We have to start embracing Kara Walker. We have to start embracing Jean-Michel Basquiat. We have to start embracing Jimi Hendrix. We have to start embracing Arthur Lee of Love, a band called Love. Some of you out there who know who that is. We have to start embracing our avant-garde black artists, because that, to me, is a singular way out of the cul-de-sac that we find ourselves in, that better known as like the crap that's calling itself hip-hop music and whatever. That's how we get out of this mindset that is so limited. We need to embrace the avant-garde, which basically says anything is possible. That's answer to that.
No, I love it. I mean, it's like what you said with the automatic writing. It makes all sense. You put it together, it makes perfectly fine sense. And I couldn't put it any better than how you said it. We got a caller waiting here, area code 901. You're on the air.
Oh, hi. This is Callie Hurtburn's mom, and I was listening to your conversation on the radio. And one of the questions I wanted to ask, because I deal with a lot of kids trying to motivate them to believe in themselves and do the impossible and stuff like that, and I noticed by being around my coworkers and stuff like that, that they buy a $2, $20 print, and they'll spend $500, $600, or $1,000 framing it up. And I wanted to know, one of the things, how do you motivate people to see that it's kind of silly to spend that kind of money on art? I mean, on prints, when you can get the real thing and promote, like you say, the starving artist or the person like you. And just overall, how can we provide that knowledge to the people?
Okay, that is a great question. We'll take it off the air, I guess, right?
Yeah.
That is a fantastic question. I'd like to thank the caller. What was her name again?
My mom.
Okay. Oh, it was Callie your mom. That's not fair, but it was a great, fantastic question. She's basically saying, look, there are people out there who will buy some, like, cheesy print someplace, maybe something they bought in a museum thing, whatever, which is okay, and then they'll spend tons of money framing it, which is very similar to the concept of like these wealthy doctors and lawyers buying mirrors instead of art.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose it's basically saying, look at how I frame this, and it's ridiculous because it's basically saying the framing's more important than the art, but the framing and the money spent on it is basically saying, look how important I am. No, the issue should be, look how important this beautiful piece of artwork is.
Right.
So your mother's right. The investment should be put in, and let me tell you, in every community in this country, there are black painters, male, female, young and old, who are making amazing works of art, who are probably asking fair prices for them, and not expensive, like a couple hundred bucks to $500 to maybe $1,000. Maybe you don't even have to frame it. It can just be hung on the wall on the stretcher that you bought it on. And that is beautiful. I'd like to address one other thing that your mom said that had to do with children. Back in 94, I found myself in D.C., and I was justifying this very thing about how certain classes are found in the fine arts versus other art forms. And my friends, who were all black artists in different in venues, some were music, some were in film, and I was in film, were saying, no, how can that be? You're being a snob, you're being a chauvinist. And I'm telling them, look, I come from New York, and I know what I'm talking about. This was in D.C. I took it a year off away from New York. And so we said, well, what would happen if we took a kid from the ghetto, a kid at risk, you know, from like a rough neighborhood in D.C., which, by the way, has its share of rough neighborhoods, and gave them all the exposure to things that Jean had, who Jean, of course, was middle class. Jean's father was a corporate executive, and he was well-educated. He went to private schools, right? So we said, hey, this is kind of like an interesting My Fair Lady Pygmalion experiment. What would happen if we took this Cockney girl, from the Cockney streets and made her a lady, and what would happen, you know? So we decided, and to make a long story short, we actually did it. We put a program together. We went to Ballou High School in southeast Anacostia, D.C., which is like a rough part of town, by the way, and we went to the art teacher, and we told him what we wanted to do. We did it purely out of the goodness of our heart. We just wanted to see what would happen. We were like social experimenting, right?
Right.
And we took these kids and we turned them on to Basquiat paintings. We turned them on to Jimi Hendrix. We turned them on to, they were high school juniors in high school. We turned them on to Charlie Mingus. We turned them on to surreal filmmakers like Godard and Louis Buñuel. We turned them on all these things, and we gave them lessons, and then we challenged them to actually make surreal films, and the films had to be dreamlike. They had to be like your dreams. Like, that was what surrealism, we explained to them. It was like dreamscapes. And they made music where they would, and we challenged them to make really far out music where they would like take a, and the kids end up taking like a drum, like a cymbal from a drum kit and spinning it on the ground like a coin, like zzz, 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 and then record it and play it backwards and make that the soundtrack to their films. We blew those kids' minds. And the whole idea and what your mother was saying was, By us introducing the avant-garde to these kids, we made them see. Now, it wasn't the point to you become an artist. That wasn't the point. The point was you, through art, see how there's no limitations. So the point to where they're walking down the street and they're seeing like black gum spots on the concrete, instead of seeing these black gum spots of gum, they're seeing like patterns in which they link them with chalk and create like a monster or something. They were all of a sudden seeing that like the cracks in the sidewalk and the air, the clouds in the air, are through this exploration in surrealism is no longer just a cloud or cracks in the sidewalk, but actually a form that you could turn into something else, which made them realize that they could turn their lives into almost anything else through art. So again, this is a way out of being a child at risk. And I would say maybe let all these other people go and only focus on the kids.
Yeah, I got another call. I mean, you get people, it's not my mom this time. This is area code 504. You're on the air.
Hi. I am so happy to be on with you, but I had a question going back to what you stated earlier about the lack of support. And I wanted to know if you felt that being that so little African Americans do support the few artists we have, the Kara Walkers, the Crystal Feelies, and Lorna Simpson. Do you think that that's why there's so few black artists that are able to break into the major contemporary art world?
Absolutely. The lack of support from the African American community is why we don't have more black painters and black conceptual artists and black sculptors and African, whatever you want to use the term. I'm sorry, I go back and forth. I'm old school, you know, I'm from the 70s. We were happy to get it to be black. but yes, absolutely. The community's lack of support, what it does is it makes an individual who wants to go into it, first of all, their parents don't support them because they don't want them to become poor, or let's just say they're poor to begin with. There's a lack of, you know, it's, yo, you got to get out there and be, you know, a rapper. You got to get out there and make money. You've got to get out there and get paper. You've got to get out there and get an education, which is important, yes. But art appears to not have a connection to making a great or decent living, and that's not entirely true. But I'll tell you what, being an artist is a rich life. It is such a rich, enriching life. And when your community does not back you up, the handful of people that do make it were strong enough to ignore the negative and lack of support. The majority of the people who don't become artists could not rise above the negativity and people saying, why are you doing this? And why would you want to become an artist? And you're just going to be starving and all that shit is corny and da 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 da. That's the problem. So yes, the woman is exactly right. Her speculation is exactly right. The lack of support in the community is why we don't have more black artists.
I'm actually just like, get it back to like, I guess like what you do. I mean, it's a thankless job sometimes, but this is the work that is necessary to do if we're going to get ahead with anything. And I'd like to ask you, you think that you see it changing with the next generation? I know I talked to Barry Gaither up from Boston, the, I guess, director of the African-American Artist Museum.
Mm-hmm.
And you say it's going to take another generation, but like hearing what your uncle was saying, he had this like Martha Jackson gallery back in the 50s and 60s. It's like people keep on singing the same old song.
Well, I here's one thing. Now, even though I'm harping, it makes no sense to ever be negative and not see a positive future. So here's my projection. I absolutely see black people, African-American people with means, they don't have to be doctors and lawyers, they can even be below that, starting to collect, starting to see the value of art, starting to see, hey, maybe I've got the next Basquiat on my hands, right? The reason why I felt that, first of all, now I don't want to be chauvinistic, being a New York chauvinist, but I am. New York is the center of the creative cultural world, not just the country. And when New York sneezes, the rest of the country, the rest of the world catches a cold.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'll tell you what I've been seeing here. Now listen, Jean Michel Basquiat had a retrospective at the Brooklyn Museum, about 4 years ago, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
3 to 4 years ago. And I was, let me tell you something, Ron, I was shocked at the number of young black and black people and children of color who crowded into the Brooklyn Museum. They knew Jean was their hero. That place was packed. It was packed with young black people and even younger, like high school age, junior high age, and college age, and just young professionals, whatever. You know, kids with their dreads, you know, kids with, you know, and when I say kids, I mean people, right? You know, all these hip kids, like, pouring in, all kinds of people. It was a mixed crowd, but there was, I'd never seen in the 20 some years I lived in New York, almost 30 years I lived in New York, I've never seen those many people of color come to a major museum retrospective of a contemporary artist. And forget the fact that it's Jean-Michel Basquiat. I don't care that he was black. This was phenomenal. This was unusual. He was their hero. And so if these kids in Brooklyn, for the most part Brooklyn, this is like, you know, Brooklyn has always been this center of intelligentsia, of black intelligentsia, and the start of a lot of important things in the world and in our country. Manhattan, yes, but Manhattan has always been, you know, Harlem, of course, but Brooklyn is a little bit ahead of Harlem in this respect. And so if 3 or 4 years ago I'm seeing like crowds and crowds of kids going to see Basquiat, I have to assume that the word is spreading. And in 4 and 5 years, that same phenomenon is going to happen in L.A. and then San Francisco. I would imagine it's already happening in San Francisco and to some degree in Atlanta, but it's going to happen more and more in Atlanta, more and more in Chicago, more and more in the large black communities in this country. And I would say that, that things are changing, that in like 10 years, there's going to be far more, three times, four times as many black fine artists who are famous, who are big, who are making money, who are doing well, and who are being collected. That's what I see. In 10 years, it's going to be very quick. It's going to happen very quickly. And it's going to be because of Jean Michel Basquiat.
You do yourself a disservice when you just say, like, it's because of this. I mean, Jean Michel Basquiat, as great as he is, he had a great PR. I mean, you was involved in basically making this, like, you know, a film called Basquiat.
That's true.
You wrote the script, right?
That's right.
And you did a lot in teaching the next generation about it, man. I mean, that movie really is one of my favorite movies of all time. I want to ask you, how do you feel about how it came out, the product, the end result of that movie?
Well, I will say thank you very much, and I'll say thank you very much to anybody out there who shares that same sentiment. But let me just say this. I knew Jean very well. And the screenplay, yes, I wrote the screenplay to it, but there were other writers, and that happens in all films. You know, someone comes along
mm-hmm.
and steps on it, then somebody else comes along and steps on it, whatever. You know, they add their 2 cents, whatever. And that was no different in Basquiat. I am very proud of the work that I did in it, but I have to tell you that the screenplay, as I wrote it, as I saw it, was quite mangled by the time Schnabel got to start directing it. He took out a lot of things that really explained who Jean really, really was, how brilliant he was. And I'm afraid to say, but Julian Schnabel, I believe very strongly, was jealous of Jean and still is jealous of Jean, and he was kicking him while he was 6 feet down. Julian Schnabel was going out of his way to make himself, the English artist.
Gary Oldman. What is that?
Gary Oldman.
I know he's him. Okay.
Gary Oldman, yeah. He had Gary Oldman play himself, and he went out of his way to make himself look good. And I have to tell you that here's what I think about the film. Here's why I think the film works, and a lot of people like it. A, because it champions a great black painter. Fantastic.
Right.
Makes everyone want to know about Jean-Michel Basquiat. Forget about why I don't like it. I'm happy for that. Thank you, Julian, for that. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Number two, my screenplay, the story structure and the structure of it and the story basically that happens that I wrote was kept. So there's a good story structure, and it's a good, you know, you can really follow it, and it's a lot of fun to watch the story happen. You know, what's interesting is a lot of people don't know this, but screenwriters steal all the time from other screenwriters. They look at other films and go, again, I'm trying to figure out an angle for my film. What film out there reminds me of the thing I need to make? And I'll tell you what I used. I used Goodfellas.
Quentin Tarantino did too with Reservoir Dogs.
Oh, really? I didn't know that. But the reason I used Goodfellas is because I was looking for a story in which somebody becomes what they want to be. See, usually in a film, a character has some dream to become something, right? To become the most famous painter, which Jean did. But usually it comes at the end of the film. But I knew that I needed him to become the famous artist very soon, like, you know, by the end of the first act, so that the second act would be the story about him surviving this
mm-hmm.
and not surviving it. So his outer goal in this film is once he's become a famous painter, to survive it, which he's unable to do. That's what that story was about. And that's what Goodfellas was about. It was about a guy who, right at the end of the first act, becomes, you know, a gangster. And the
mm-hmm.
whole second act is him trying to survive it, trying to survive these crazy friends he has, you know, with Robert De Niro and Joe Pesci, who are, like, killing people left and right. Jean's mm-hmm. trying to survive the art world. So I modeled it after that. People probably don't know that. I'm giving it away now. But there were some amazing scenes that I put in there that where Jean didn't say a word, but you saw, you understood how brilliant he was. And Julian Schnabel clipped those scenes, and I'm convinced he did it because he didn't want Jean to look that brilliant. And I was just writing scenes that happened as they happened. Like, for example, there's the one scene where William Burroughs, which I thought was kind of cool, he played the hotline, suicide hotline operator. Jean calls up a suicide hotline and reads his poems to the suicide hotline. And the poems that Jean wrote were brilliant, Ron. They were brilliant. It was probably, to me, one of the most brilliant things that Jean ever did was this piece that he did calling the suicide hotline operator. And what he said, and I could tell you some of the lines. And Julian took out what I wrote, which is basically what Jean said, and changed it and implied that Jean was bisexual, which, by the way, he was. He experimented with everything. But that's not what the poem said. And Julian outed Jean. Who the hell is he to out Jean? You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So basically what really happened in the suicide hotline was, and Jean was very young when he did. He was probably like 18 or 19 at this point. He's a genius. I mean, he's like a beyond genius. He calls up the suicide hotline. Guy comes on the phone, and he's about to say, suicide hotline, can I help you, whatever. But Jean doesn't even let him. Jean right away launches, he's reading from his poetry book, his composition book that he has a bunch of poems in, and he says, do I have to fill out a form to get my liquid cigarettes? It was always cheaper to get hijacked Marlboros from the trustees. And the guy goes, what, huh, what? And he says, do I have to fill out a form? He says, what form? What form are you talking about? He's thinking, I've got to save this guy, right? And Jean is just blowing his mind. He says, you know, hijack Marlboros, the trustees. He goes, what are you talking about? He says, black, white, gray, these last few months. Black, white, gray, these last few months. Canceled checks. The police arrived. And he goes, what are you talking about? What police? And he goes, and Jean says, you won't be so arrogant when the police arrive. And he goes, what? I'm not trying to be arrogant. And then the guy, no, before he said that, the guy would go, wait, the guy, you could tell in his voice, I have the recording of it. You can tell the guy in his voice says, you can tell by his voice he's going, what is this? Are you trying to like, what are you trying to pull here? But it's so bizarre. It doesn't sound like a Yanker joke. It sounds like something really bizarre. And he's kind of going, well, so what kind of liquid cigarettes are you talking about? The operator's saying, what do you, how many do you want? A lot, a little? And Jean slammed him. He says, you won't be so arrogant when the police arrive. And the guy, the ground from under the guy falls out from under him. And he's like, no, what? I'm not trying to be arrogant. What do you mean? And then Jean just, he played with him like a cat plays with a mouse.
Wow.
Through his poetry, he never once said anything normal. All he ever did was read from his poetry. And this guy, he had this guy wound up like you would not believe, and it was one of the greatest moments in art, audio art history. If you ask me,
he got the recorded.
I have it recorded. Now listen, I wrote that scene verbatim, just exactly the way Jean said it and the way the guy said it. I cut it down because it was too long, but I used all these choice, tasty things that I'm telling you, right? Julian Schnabel changed it for what you see in the film now. That should give you an idea of how upset I am about how that film was made.
Well, you think about, are you going to make another film? I mean, like, you ever think about that?
I'll tell you what, well, that's what I wanted to talk to the guy who had so much money, who had too much money.
I'll definitely put you into him, yeah. I'll definitely put you in with him.
Here's the skinny. I just finished a screenplay called Searching for Old Tin. It's my revenge film. Quickly, what it is, I feel bad that I'm associated with Basquiat because of what Julian did. And because of my friends who all knew Jean are like, man, why did he do that? And I refused to see the film. So I need retribution. I'm not revenge, just I need to correct the record. And so I've written a screenplay called Searching for Old Tin. What's it about? It's about three old friends. Based on myself, Nick Taylor, who is also in Gray with Jean and I, and Jean's favorite girlfriend, we call her the Widow Basquiat, Suzanne Malouk. And these three characters are in the script, are kind of poor and hard up, and they've had hard times. They haven't done as well as Jean, for sure, and a lot of other people, and they're kind of desperate. And all of a sudden, it occurs to them that they know where there's a hidden Basquiat. Painted on a handball court, which now must be under years and years and layers of paint. And they go on this, and what they find out very early in the script is that the handball court that they thought it was on had been torn down years ago. But then they realize that there's another one, another painting called Old Tin, and that begins the second act. The film is about them searching for this painting, which they believe, obviously, is going to be worth millions of dollars. But here's the beauty of it. Because these are all old friends of Jean, they're trying to remember, they're trying to figure out where this painting is, and they figure if they can get into Jean's head, they might be able to figure out where it is, right? Mm-hmm. And so by getting into Jean's head, they're talking about all the things he used to do and all the crazy things he'd say and da-da-da-da-da. And so through them trying to remember these things, I'm telling the audience about the real Jean Michel Basquiat that you don't see in the film.
That's a beautiful way of doing it, man.
And that's my elevator pitch.
Oh, yeah, I like it.
Film producers out there, give me a call.
We definitely get this out here. And I got another email from Jessica from San Francisco.
Cool.
She got this question. Said, do you see a difference in how celebrities were treated in the early 80s in New York as opposed to contemporary U.S. culture? For instance, how do you feel, about how much emphasis is placed on Paris Hilton?
Great. Another brilliant question. You've got the best audience, man.
I mean, they're well-informed people, man. They know their stuff.
This is like a dope audience. This is like because, you know, all three of these questions, especially the last one, are things that I think about all the time because I'm stuck kind of in the past in some ways, you know. And so, anyway, to answer the question, thank you for that question, by the way. It's brilliant. By the way, I was born in San Francisco. I went to college there. Went to high school there. But I was an Army brat. I lived all over the world, but part of my life was spent in San Francisco, so I'm like a Cali kid. I went to USF, go Dons, and I went to Lowell High School. I forget what the Lowell High School mascot was. But anyway, yes, the way celebrities treat it. I hate to say this, and I sound like an ageist and a chauvinist, but back in those days, it was a big thing. In New York, and in New York, it's still that way compared to the rest of the country. It was a big thing that if you saw a celebrity walking down the street, that you like mad igged them. You mad ignored them.
I like that.
You know, you treated them like they were anybody else. Because like, yo, man, okay, so you're like, I remember walking down 57th Street and seeing Tupac Shakur. Or 57th Street, I saw so many people. I saw Anthony Quinn. I saw Jackie Onassis, because 57th Street, there's a lot of lawyers' offices that deal with celebrities. And, you know, like Harry Belafonte, who's a friend of mine, his office would be on 50, you know, people, just a lot of people on 56th and 57th and 58th Street. And it was a big deal to where you go like, so you're a celebrity, big deal, so what?
Like bad
and
things,
there's that still that element in New York, which I don't think is out in the rest of the country, but here's how it's even changed in New York. Here's where I sound like an ageist and a chauvinist ageist in that I think my age might be hipper than another age. I think that somehow the young generation in many ways, not in every way, but in many ways, and I mean like people in their 20s and whatever, they've kind of dropped the ball. Like they kind of got soft.
Right.
Like they're not hardcore. And they're into like kind of lame things like the music seems lamer than it was in the day, the films are definitely lamer, and it's not in a way that doesn't necessarily their fault. It's really the fault of what's happened is that we are now all worshiping at the altar of money, and the reason why people like Paris Hilton are important is because they somehow represent wealth. Whereas we had celebrities that were broke, but they were stars in New York.
Right.
Like this guy, he was I forget his name. He was poor as a church mouse, but he came from London and he was in a film called The Naked Civil Servant. He was played by John Hurt, but the real guy, I forget what his name is now. It'll come to me. He's a famous English character. He was just a kind of a guy who was dressed really crazy. He was a cross-dresser. He was kind of a strange cat.
Uh-huh.
But people loved to have him at his parties, and they talked to him on the street, and da-da-da. He was kind of a celebrity. And you know, and another thing, you know, at the Mug Club, you know, we'd go out to the Mug Club, and you know, you'd see Johnny Lydon there, or you'd see, like, you know, Andy Warhol, or you'd see, you know, Iggy Pop, or like different celebrities and stars, and it was like, yeah, so what, you know, or, you know, we're cooler than you. That was our attitude. You're here because of us, because we started this like dope ass scene. So you're here because of us. So that makes us cooler than you. We're not at your house. We're not at your club. You're at our club. So we had this attitude. We had this attitude, and unfortunately, the night scene, that type of night scene, nightclub scene in New York doesn't exist anymore. The new generation of kids that came to New York looking for that didn't know that we made that scene happen. We didn't. Nobody handed it to us, and so they showed up expecting somebody to like hand them the scene, and so there was no scene. And it wasn't only their fault. Also, the cabaret laws killed the scene. Like people like Giuliani and Bloomberg thinks he's a champion of the working people. That guy's killing New York. He's making it only for rich people. There's no nightlife like there was. There's no Studio 50. Do you know of a Studio 54 in New York or something like it? It doesn't exist. It's over.
Mm.
You know? Do you know that like by the 90s, by the time the 90s hit, the nightlife that dominated New York for, what, 200 years was over, was dead. And now it's all private clubs. You have to have money to get in, and you have to be for money. The kind of places, the Bungalow 8, where, like, you know, Paris Hilton goes to. You know, I'm glad she was put in jail, because I was standing outside of an art opening, minding my own business with my friends. It was a Kenny Scharf art opening, and she and her bodyguards were coming down the sidewalk, heading towards Bungalow 8, and. We're like, we were the type of crowd, you know, myself, Kenny Sharp, we're like, girl, you don't even like, you can't even like clean our shoes. That's how we feel about you. We wouldn't even want to pay attention. And their bodyguards knocked us off the sidewalk so that she could come through. And it was like, we don't give a damn about her. We're not going to go groping after her. Are you crazy? And they knocked us off the sidewalk. So good for her. I hope she rots in jail. What a horrible thing that we worship somebody like her who has no talent, who has nothing to say other than, look at me, I'm rich.
Mm.
She has nothing to say. You know, there wouldn't have been anybody like that in the 60s and 70s. Nobody would have cared anything about like somebody like that. Think about this. LL Cool J is a huge star, partly in a big way, because of his muscles.
Well. Not because of his rapping skills, I mean.
Because of his muscles.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that if somebody came out in the 70s or 60s or 70s with a bunch of muscles like that, you know what they would think of them? Like if James Brown or if Jim Morrison of the Doors or somebody like, or some like, you know, really great like, you know, rock band or soul band or whatever, everybody was like skinny and nobody had any. If you came out with muscles, you know what the first thing they'd think was that you were gay. That was gay thing. Muscles was a gay thing.
Wow.
I mean, I'm not putting down gay people, but I'm just saying that, to me, that is so weak that, oh, man, we our stars are great because they have muscle. That's, like, absurd. What about having a good song? What about writing great music? No. He's got muscles. Don't worry about the music. He's got great muscles, you know. It's cool, bro. Don't worry. You're getting excited here. Just focus on the muscles. I don't want to look at the muscles, dude. I want to hear, like, a good song. I've been starving for good music for years. Mm. You know, what happened to, like, brilliant bands like Diggable Planet, KRS-One? I mean, if you want to hear great hip-hop music, man, and that's hip-hop. That's not rap. That's hip-hop. KRS-One, Diggable Planet, geniuses. Why did they die out? Because the kids today didn't think that they were important enough to, like, support. Man, that is sad. Now I sound like an old curmudgeon, but, you know.
But you look at, B.C., before Chronic and after Chronic, you know, the album, they changed a lot of things, too.
Say again?
Like, when the Chronic came out, it changed the game.
That's true.
A lot of guy plays on the radio. I mean,
that's
like,
totally
before,
true.
Was
that was
diverse.
Really artistic.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't hear that anymore. It's almost like now it's like everything, music, film, everything's void of art. It feels, that's how it feels to me. I mean, I'm not letting that happen. I'm fighting the good fight, but it seems like it's like this. How do we make a profit? Well, guess what? If you want to make a profit, the guaranteed profit is to sell to the lowest common denominator. And when you make something that you intentionally make stupid, and it says something stupid, and it appeals to stupid people, that's how you make money. It didn't used to be that way in the 60s, man. You'd see TV shows like you still get to see them, but they were really great, like the Ernie Kovacs show or Twilight Zone or they were like, there was really fantastic TV. There still is good TV, like an HBO. I'd give HBO.
Right, but on cable, problem. Though. I mean, like, on keyword, you got to pay for it more.
Got to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
But what's great about HBO and paying for it is they've extracted themselves from the selling to the lowest common denominator paradigm, which commercial TV, you know, regular broadcast TV, feels that they're forced to do.
Mm-hmm.
So the HBOs can say, no, we're gonna sell to the people who want to buy into us, and we'll give them good fare. And HBO is one shining light of that, of a reaction to what I'm complaining about. You know, The Sopranos, Entourage. There's not enough diversity, but they're certainly decent shows. And
I agree with you on that.
You know, The Wire is a little. Wire's a little negative for me. I'd like to see a TV show with black people where it's not like depressing every second.
you guys are one of the few people I heard say that. I mean, I know where you're coming from with that, but like, it is weird to me that show never gets nominated for an Emmy, it seems, or anything, any type of recognition.
Yeah, but that's playing to the 300-year-old now paradigm of minstrelism.
Right.
Minstrelly, what do you call it? It's like if you, I've said this before and I'll say it again, if you're black and you're willing to debase yourself on a national stage, they will bring wheelbarrows full of gold for you.
Mm-hmm.
They will make you a god. If you're willing to debase yourself, if you're willing to play the coon, if you're willing to play the clown, there's not enough money to give you. You will be the richest man. And unfortunately, we try hard to give props to certain people, but unfortunately, you can count on one hand black entertainers, artists, filmmakers, you know, actors, whatever, who don't fall into the minstrel paradigm. I mean, I will say that who won the Academy Award last year?
Forrest Whitaker.
Forrest Whitaker is not of that world. He is of a world unto himself. He is a true artist. I would say that Donald Cheadham is kind of like in a cutting edge way, kind of a very indie cutting edge way.
Mm-hmm.
I will say that the biggest black star being what's his name?
Will Smith.
Huh? No. Will Smith is the minstrel. I'm sorry, but he's the.
Oh yeah, I'm glad you said I.
No, I was talking about the handsome brother who all the women love and da da da.
Denzel
Washington. I think Denzel Washington rises above the minstrel show. I think Forrest Whitaker rises above the minstrel show, and I think that Donald Cheadle and rises above the minstrel show. I think that there's only a small number of musicians that do. I think there's a small number. In the fine arts, you sort of do by definition. I think for the most part, everybody says, look, the white world, the white American world, and the black American world is expecting and has been accustomed to this minstrel paradigm that has been in existence for hundreds of years, and if you play that role, it's familiar, it's comfortable, and it's easy. And, you know, no offense to the white listeners out there, but for the most part, the role that the black minstrel plays is, in the end of the day, is designed to make the white man feel superior about himself, which,
right,
in a world like we have today, feeling good and superior about yourself is a very addictive and very seductive thing to want to feel. The way I see it is that we're the drug and we're the dealer. We're the drug. The drug that we supply is, we make you feel better about yourself. We make you feel superior. We make you feel great, because here we come shucking and jiving, and I'm sorry, but rap is just another form of shucking and jiving today, the way it, for the most part, the way it's played out. And so when we do that, whether you're a dangerous minstrel, which they had in the 19th and 18th century, they had dangerous minstrels that pulled knives out,
right.
And they had the clowning, cooning minstrels. And if you're willing to play that role, you are the drug. You're better than cocaine. You're better than cocaine. You make the man feel better about himself than cocaine does. So you're not only the drug, you're the dealer. You're the pusher.
Like Curtis Mayfield said, huh? I'm your mommy, I'm daddy, I'm your push in the alley, huh?
Well, I'm your mommy, I'm daddy, I'm that nigga in the alley. But Curtis Mayfield is another person who transcends every expectation of what a black musician artist should be. He was beyond that. He was so beyond that. I mean, I love Curtis Mayfield. I mean, God, you know, I think of his unfortunate early demise, and I think about who and what he was and what he said, and people like you know, oh God, I'm having like, you know, when I have to remember these names, Marvin Gaye. I mean, just these geniuses. And even though somebody might say, oh my God, you know, James Brown is you know, this wild crazy man, he can hardly da 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 da, he's got to be playing the coon, but somehow he was so brilliant that he transcended that paradigm too. But where's the James Brown of today? Please don't tell me Prince. I'm sorry, young people of today. Prince is no James Brown. He can't come close. The only song I ever liked of Prince was like The Beautiful Ones. That's the only, I mean, I'm sorry. He's no James Brown. Sorry. I don't know how we got to that, though.
I don't know. I mean, I go back. Like,
I get to say whatever I want to say.
Oh, yeah, you can say whatever you want to say, but I will get back to, like, you talking about the coon minstrel thing. It's like,
right.
Until people understand that entertainment's country is meant for white people, because I think about Ira Aldridge, a New Yorker who had to leave this country because he refused to put their black face on. He went over to England.
Right.
And, you know, take himself seriously, but also, like, you talk about the minstrel show where they had the coons. They pull out the knife. People don't even understand that there were two types of coons. Like, you had Jim Crow, the one that everybody knows, and he had Zip the Coon. That's the city slicker. Or the city slick coon, the one that plopped the knives and whatnot.
But he was dangerous.
And like, how do you justify, like, you know, to me, it's like, what do you think about Bert Williams then? Or George Walker or anybody from that era that had to wear the blackface? I mean, Florence Mills. I mean, because these folks were very well read as far as, like, the history of African Americans and Africans and world history. I mean, Bert Williams had a personal library of over, like, 800 to 1,000 books about, you know, black people with importance to the world.
Well, I mean, you know, you could very easily say, you know, he had no other choice. I mean, they were not going to let him do anything else.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, the sad thing is like, today, do we have any choice either? For example, you saw Basquiat, right?
Right, I saw it.
Do you remember when, you know, Benicio del Toro was like a conglomerate character? He played a lot of different people. In one person. And do you remember when, and I don't know if anyone else out there remembers when he says, Jean, take a look at this film I made. Do you remember this moment? And on the screen for like about a minute, I was really surprised. It was a black and white film but it wasn't me. It was Vincent Gallo flying through the air in this pixelated kind of arty short film that I made. It was my film that I licensed to Julian Schnabel to use for that one moment in Basquiat. Vincent Gallo said it was the best part of the film. I said, thank you very much. But the point is that, you know, I'm a black artist, and I was making that film, and a lot of other films that I made are abstract, they're surreal, they're bugged out, they're different, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, does the general market want to see that? Or do they want to see, you know, Ice Cube doing, you know, are we, you know, whatever.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. I mean, he G's off on that. I know he probably was probably the top film for the weekend, you know, probably last week or whatever. It was probably the biggest film for a week, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he G's off. But, you know, I cry when I see stuff like that, you know, inside. I'm like, you know, how great would it have been for somebody who had been an NWA, who was like a cutting-edge band at the time, say, I'm going to continue this edginess in my filmmaking, in everything I do. But it's, no, I'm going to make all the money I can because I want to compete with, you know, Spike Lee, and I want to compete with, you know, whoever, whatever, who's making, you know, tons of money and da-da-da-da-da. And it just breaks my heart, you know. It's just like, why would you want to make a film like that? I mean, why not push the envelope? But it just seems that you know, people in power are not interested in pushing the envelope. But like I said, it's happening. There's a groundswell. And I believe it may take 10 years, but I believe that the artistic landscape of the country is going to change profoundly. And the biggest, the most profound change is going to be within the black community.
Wow. Well, Mark, I mean, we got this recorded in the archive and dated, so we're going to remember when you said this. And
this is dope, right? I love the fact that this is all in the archives. You're giving me a copy of all this, right?
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All right.
And you got anything else to add? I'm definitely want to bring you back on We All Be Radio so we can continue our dialogue. I mean, you are a very phenomenal person. I mean, you, in your own right, is like a consummate artist. And, I mean, you got a legacy that's very rich and varied, and it's going to be around for a long, long, long time. So is there anything else you'd like to add for this night?
Well, what could I say in closing? I will say this. I would love to come back and have another session like this. I'm having a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a lot more to say, as you can well imagine.
Oh, yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
I can talk. Let me tell you what.
Mm-hmm.
I can talk my, you know, behind off. But in New York, we would say something else. But anyway,
right.
What would I say in ending? I would say, and I'm going to reiterate what I said earlier, I believe that though there's been a lot of progress in a lot of different ways, in many unfortunate ways, especially from an artist's point of view of which I am, there's been a lot of very sad regressions and devolution, going backward. Okay, for us, but for everybody, let me tell you something. You know, the larger white market of art and film and music and everything is just as bad as everything. Everybody's doing really terribly, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And but it's especially alarming when I see it amongst our people. That's who I'm more sensitive about. I want to see us do better. I'm more embarrassed when we don't do well, when we look like fools. I mean, you know, I'm like anybody else. I want to see us do first. And this conversation came up when Kathy Hughes, who many of you out there know, is a billionaire radio mogul who owns all these radio stations and now owns TV One, et cetera, right? And she came to Howard, where I teach, and where I'm the chair of the Paul Robeson Awards, which is our Academy Awards.
Mm-hmm.
For the best films and best sound and best editing and da 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 best acting of that year's films because I teach in the film department.
Mm.
And so she was our honoree. Every year we have an honoree, and so she was our honoree. And after she's honored and given the plaque, the next day we had this big discussion, and we talked about the IMUS thing, and we talked about, you know, responsibility amongst us ourselves to police our own language, to police. I don't think the language is as important, using the N-word or not, is as important as the way is our attitude towards ourselves, as is our attitudes of wanting to like to expand. I've heard this said by many different people, and I agree. Rap music, especially now, has become a celebration of stupidity. It's like, I'm stupid, and look how I'm getting paid. I'm getting paper. I'm stupid, and isn't that fabulous? That's what rap music is basically about today.
Mm-hmm.
And it is, and you see the behavior. I was on the train coming back up from D.C. yesterday, coming back home to New York. Nice train ride, a lot of business people. And here's this brother from Philadelphia with his pants down his ass, which is fine, no puzzle. He's on his cell phone literally making drug deals. Cursing. And people are just cringing. I'm cringing. Just, oh, God. People are cringing and trying not to hear it, and they're trying to read their books. And this guy is totally, he's basically saying, I'm hip-hop down, and hip-hop gives me the license to behave this way. Rap music. I'm not going to say hip-hop. I'm not blaming hip-hop culture. I'm blaming rap music. Rap music gives me license to behave this way. And I'm sorry, but I think we're slipping. And Kathy Hughes said, what's the answer? And people gave their different ideas and, you know, what we could do. And I think there are many answers, But I have my own pet one, and it goes back to the King's Court Project, that program that I created in D.C., you know, where we turned on kids to the avant-garde that I mentioned earlier. I believe that the way we find ourselves out of the cultural, intellectual, educational, technological rut, quagmire that we are in this country and that Africa is in, and African people are in around the world, the way we find our way out of that is to embrace the avant-garde, embrace the new, embrace the different, be on the avant-garde, be on the vanguard, study avant-garde filmmakers, study avant-garde musicians and music, like the Stockhausens and the don't worry about whether they're white or European. Study, but Mingus and Coltrane are equally in there. Study the painters of the avant-garde. Study the photography of the avant-garde. Study the avant-garde, because within the avant-garde, to me, this is my opinion, is the key that unlocks this cage. It is the road, the yellow brick road that we can go down to find a new way of thinking, to find a new way of seeing the world around us, to free us from this race war that we've been in for the last 400, 300 years. Frankly, I'm sorry, we are in a race war.
Right.
You know, whether people like to admit it or not, we're at each other's throats. So-and-so is a traitor. So-and-so is an ally. So that's warfare talk.
Right, it is.
You know, let's embrace our friends on both sides of the aisle. Let's embrace our friends of all stripes, because this world is a precarious place. We need to look forward to the avant-garde to save ourselves, and then we need to look at our responsibilities to this planet. We can't say, let the white people take care of it.
Right.
We're out there buying those SUVs too. We're out there polluting too.
Right.
You know, You can have a race problem till the you know, cows come home, but at least you can breathe the air so you can argue about it.
Yeah, I like that point. That's a great point.
But if you can't breathe the air, if the atmosphere is gone, if the ozone layer is gone, doesn't matter damn whether you hate, you know, whitey or not. Nobody's gonna be around. We all have to work together on this. We all have to work together to save the planet. We all have to work together to save ourselves. And in both cases, we have to look to the new, to the different, and be willing. Here's another important thing, and I'll leave you with this to the audience. Yeah, you want to G off. Yeah, you want to blow up. Yeah, you want to make money. I understand that. You don't want to be poor. Maybe you've come from poverty. But let me tell you something. There's nothing richer than to have your heart and your soul and your mind open and rich. That's richness. And you want to embrace knowledge, you want to embrace art, you want to embrace beauty. Because money is fleeting. It comes and goes. But beauty and knowledge in the heart stays forever. Be willing to be on the avant-garde, where maybe you're not going to G off and you're not going to make a lot of money, but you're going to be the first to do this, the first to do that, the first to come up with this idea, the pioneer to pave the way. I hope that there's enough people out there who are courageous enough, who believe in enough in their music or in their art or in their poetry or in their filmmaking to say, I'm not going to compromise. I'm not going to compromise just to make money. I believe in what I'm doing. I believe in this film style that I'm doing. I believe in this musical style that I'm doing. Even though it would blow people's minds when it comes out, I'm sticking with it, because 10, 5 years, 1 year later, they're all going to be on your jock. They're all going to be like, oh, man, that's so brilliant. Yeah, I thought you said it was like crazy 5 years ago. Now they're all on it. That's what's going to happen. Stay true to your heart. Stay true to your soul. When you make something that you know is brilliant, don't compromise. Stick with it, because that's the only way that we're going to like break through to the other side. And with that, America, I say a fond adieu until we meet again.
Oh, thanks so much for blessing us tonight, Mr. Michael Holman.
Thank you, Ron.
They can get a hold of you on www.michaelholman.com. That's www.michael and then Holman, HOLMAN.com, and we definitely have you back on, sir. I mean, you're very inspiring, motivational, and you are a true national treasure. And beyond that, I mean, you're priceless.
Thank you.
To be honest with you. And I look forward to helping you any way I can to get, you know, whatever you need to get done.
Well, we got some films. We got to get some of these ill films to make. We got to get ill on the film tip, man. Let's make some of these films I'm talking about. Let's get bugged out.
Yes, sir. We are going to definitely do that. I have a feeling that we're going to be working closely together in the future.
Thank you, and thank you, everybody out there listening. It means a lot. I feel your hearts out there. I really do. And let's get into the future on the good foot.
I like that. James Brown style. I like that.
Yep. Peace, all.
And on that note, that does it for tonight's edition of We All Be Radio. We'll say adieu in the words of Mr. Holman, and we'll see you next time on We All Be Radio.